As this is the second lecture, I did another one 3 weeks ago, and as I intend to pursue a little on the same subject, I will first of all try to resume in a few words the walk I proposed 3 weeks ago, resume the four moments or objects I proposed to you to stimulate a reflection on the relationship between architecture, landscape, and memory. Maybe we can have the slides. And that walk went from the antique idea of the art of memory, that is, of architecture, of mental architecture, being used and considered as a mnemonic device, an instrument for memory, to memory being addressed today as a fundamental dimension of architecture and landscape architecture. So this walk went through this evocation of this art of memory, as it has been described by historian Francis Yates, to this fantastic four-dimensional Rome, as it is evoked by Sigmund Freud as an equivalent of the complex psyche. And Sigmund Freud, you remember, described himself as an archaeologist of the psyche, as a psyche archaeologist. We went also around Robert Smithson, his sightseeing approach to modern suburbia, leading him to those powerful on-site intervention, which envisage suburban land and suburban ground as a city below, as he said, material memory to explore and to reveal. And finally, we stopped a few time in the Parc de Lancy by Georges Descombes, which is, in my opinion, one of the most interesting and challenging attempts in suburbanism, a project which in this suburban area deeply and violently transformed during the last decades has managed, through very discreet but elaborate interventions, a little tunneled footbridge, a little pergola, a few concrete steps descending a slope, a sandbox connected to a fountain channeled on a little concrete wall, etc., has managed to make simultaneously legible the different memory planes or layers which have shaped this site, allowing this marginal area, this suburban area, to become a matrix onto which people can project, can unfold their own, the different mental planes of their own memory and imagination. And I concluded my promenade by simply quoting three questions asked by Colin Rowe in College City. And I just recall you those three questions. Why should we be obliged to prefer a nostalgia for the future to that of the past? Second, could not the model city which we carry in our minds allow for our known psychological constitution, meaning or need to unfold, to project onto space, urban space, or the mental planes of our own psychological organization? And third question, could not this ideal city at one and the same time behave quite explicitly as both a theater of prophecy and a theater of memory?
As you
certainly know, these questions, which explicitly referred to the book of Francis Yates, are the last words of the second chapter of College City, significantly called After the Millennium. And when I read those three questions 3 weeks ago here, in fact, I didn't know. I was told just after, during the dinner we had with friends, I was told that Colin Rowe had died a few weeks before. And so just before this famous millennium. I must say that it was quite, this bad news was quite moving for me. Of course, there is nothing personal in this. I never had a chance to meet Colin Rowe, and besides, I discovered his work only very recently, 1 or 2 years ago. And to aggravate my case, I must confess that I have read seriously only two of his numerous writings, the essay on transparency and College City. So I am probably the one here who knows less Colin Rowe in this room. And besides those two texts, those two essays, Transparency and College City, as you know, are two pieces that have been produced in collaboration with Sparring Partners. Robert Slutsky for Transparency in 1955, and which was written while the authors were both Texas Rangers teaching in Austin and Fred Kurter for College City, written in the 70s, 20 years after that, while Colin Rowe was teaching in Cornell and published as a book in 1978, if I remember well. But so ignorant that I am of Colin Rowe's work, as you see, I hold these two pieces in very high esteem, and I place them in my own personal pantheon of reader among the most brilliant and stimulating pieces of critical thought about architecture I have ever read. So I will be, and excuse myself, I will be repeating some little things I have touched with the students in the seminar. But for this reason, I have decided to take those two texts as my points of departure tonight. And this lecture could be entitled, if I had to invent another title, From Architecture to Landscape, or Transparency Extrapolated, or Playing on Words, Colin Rowe in Memoriam. In a recent review essay called Form Without Utopia, Contextualizing Colin Rowe, that was published 2 years ago in the Journal of the Society of Architectural Historians, Joan Ockman explains that the continuing theme of Colin Rowe's work and thought has been the failure of the utopian project of modernism, the naive and tragic aspiration on the part of modern architects to construct the future of society through architecture. Believing itself to be engaged in a bout with destiny, modern architecture engendered only a morning after nausea, in Colin Rowe's judgment. This theme leads him to attack all zeitgeist conceptions of architecture, whether inspired by Hegelian, Christian, Marxian, socialist, techno-futurist, or any other teleologies, and ultimately to project his gaze both backward and forward. Backward to pre-modern architectural theories frankly based on style and taste, forward to the possibilities of form, to disburdened of absolutist apologetics and a postmodern end of ideology, end of quoting. In this sense, Colin Rowe, has been one of the leading figures of the revision of the modern movement, a revision which has led to reconsidering the modern movement as a style, a formal style in the history of architecture, instead of a social and political utopia. So, in Colin Rowe, we find, in one word, an admiration for the great buildings of the modern movement, but a symmetrical despise for their urbanismus, urban theories, and utopia, a despise for their ideologies. The great question facing Colin Rowe throughout his work being how to save, that's the words of John Oakman in this essay, how to save the baby while throwing out the bathwater. That is, how to salvage modernism from both its misguided missionary vocation and its devolution at the hands of mainstream culture. So, having identified this theme as being the continuing and obsessive preoccupation of Colin Rowe's thought, Oakman, in this very beautifully written text, makes a somewhat paradoxical, but in my opinion, very accurate statement. She writes, "While partaking of the nimble wit of the fox, Rowe unquestionably qualifies as a hedgehog." This, as you know, refers to a very famous passage, moment, in College City, where Colin Rowe borrows to Isaiah Berlin, the writer, the opposition of the fox and the hedgehog, and try to apply it, this opposition, to architects, and particularly to modern architects. So to resume the argument, there is a sentence by Berlin which says, "The fox knows many things, but the hedgehog knows one big thing," meaning that the hedgehog draws everything to one big central question he carries with himself everywhere, while the fox, on the contrary, adapts his argument to each situation. So the idea of Berlin is that the great men of Earth, on Earth, equally divide between those two categories, those two kinds of characters. While Plato, Dante, Dostoevsky, and Proust are hedgehogs, symmetrically, Aristotle, Shakespeare, Pushkin, and Joyce are foxes. So playing the game of the fox and the hedgehog in art and architecture, Rowe shows or says that while Mondrian is a hedgehog, Picasso is a fox. While Palladio is a hedgehog, Giulio Romano is a fox. Hawksmoor, hedge fox. Wren, fox. Soane, hedgehog. Nash, fox. And the last sentence of Colin Rowe here is, "Closer to the present day, while Wright, Frank Lloyd Wright, is unequivocally a hedgehog, Lloyd Jones is as obviously a fox. But the problem, says Colin Rowe here, is that this equilibrium seems to disappear among modern architects. Among them, the single central idea or single central vision of the hedgehog seems to prevail. For, and I am quoting, I quote here Colin Rowe, for if Gropius, Mies, Hannes Meyer, Buckminster Fuller are clearly eminent hedgehogs, then where are the foxes whom we can enter in the same league? And here, as you may know, Rowe refers to, he refers again to Berlin, Berlin explaining that Tolstoy, who was a fox by nature, believed in being a hedgehog. That his gifts and achievements are one thing, and that his beliefs and consequently his interpretation of his own achievement are another thing. And so Colin Rowe, paralleling Le Corbusier to Tolstoy, Rowe answers his own question by saying that Corbusier is another case of a fox as an architect assuming hedgehog disguise for the purpose of public appearances, that is, when he is an urbanist. This formula has been very successful, and I suppose everybody in this room knows it, even those who have not read the book. And in fact, it sums up very well the critical attitude assumed by Colin Rowe in the book, an attitude being promoting a new concordia, a new reconciliation of the theaters of prophecies, that is, the buildings, the wonderful buildings of the modern movement, these wonderful objects, with the theaters of memory, the complex cities, always more or less inherited from the past, but which, like Imperial Rome, Imperial Forum here, which is able, in Colin Rowe's judgment, is able to welcome those bubbles of prophecy, of ideal, of futurism, provided that they negotiate their nestling and their digestion into the complex texture of the old cities, of cities. A fox assuming hedgehog disguise for the purposes of public appearances. This funny formula also rings a bell. There is, in another wonderful and very stimulating book, which is in fact almost the exact contemporary of College City, a very similar rhetorical formula. In Delirious New York, right in the middle of the book, is published this photograph of 1931 showing Manhattan's architects performing the skyline of New York. And having identified each of these architects and their buildings, the caption under the photograph simply says, on a laconic tone, "Research disguised as costume ball." And this, in its turn, is not just a joke, but rather a very deep and very serious statement disguised as a joke. Kohlhaas explains in the text that this ball is in fact a congress, that this ceremony is Manhattan counterpart of the CIAM Congress on the other side of the Atlantic. A delirious grope after the spirit of the age, the zeitgeist precisely, and its implications for their increasingly megalomaniac profession. This idea of disguise, of mask, of costume, of a disguised counterpart of the CIAM is, as you know, central to Kohlhaas' thesis in Delirious New York. The Manhattanism, the culture of congestion, had to stay masked and concealed in order to achieve its own ambition, its own plan, its own overwhelming success. While on one side, the modern city that was publicized as such by the CIAM, that of the Chartres d'Athènes, never managed to be built as such or utterly failed when it did, in Colin Rowe's judgment, at least, the one that succeeded on the other side, Manhattan, did so by keeping its strategy unformulated, downplaying it as entertainment. So, translating this into Colin Rowe's language, it would be very tempting to describe these Manhattan architects as probable foxes, being the exact counterparts of the CIAM hedgehogs. But behind those architects, strategists like Hugh Ferris, Raymond Hood, William Corbett, the heroes of Delirious New York, and maybe their ghostwriter himself, Rem Koolhaas, could be maybe also described as exact symmetrics of Le Corbusier, hedgehogs assuming fox disguise for their public appearances. Or rather, if you prefer, hedgehogs disguised into hedgehogs to let people believe that they are foxes, in fact. But to finish with these formulas, what I mean to say is that the two books, despite the antagonism of their models, are much comparable. Each of them proposes an urban model or frame, which is valued and praised by them for its ability to welcome the great objects and bubbles of prophecy imagined by the modern movement. One, the one of Colin Rowe, by socializing and digesting these buildings in the complexity of its texture. The other, Manhattan, by simply organizing their coexistence as individuals. The one, if you prefer, by smoothing their contours, the other by simply allowing their mutual ignorance or sharp confrontation. Despite Delirious New York being much more perfectly controlled and College City more, maybe more loosely written and more openly written. A further comparison of the two books would reveal, I think, many common preoccupations, but also many common formal features, and even many parallels in the constructions of the arguments and oppositions. As an example, I will just mention the analogous appendixes or excursus of the two books, which are appended to at the end of each of these two books. A catalogue of objets trouvés for Colin Rowe, ready-made projects to be used in the urban collage and bricolage, and a series of architectural projects for Kohlhaas, conceived as the provisional products of a conscious and deliberate Manhattanism, whose pertinence, he precises, is no longer limited to the island of its invention. You see, those two movements. Many objets trouvés that we can gather in a city, many provisional projects designed for Manhattan that can migrate in others. So there are many symmetries between those two books. And another common feature, I think, and I will finish by this last common feature, is a strong taste for Platonic dialectics, that is, for emblematic binary oppositions of concepts, ideas, figures, and projects. This is, of course, particularly true for Colin Rowe, and especially true for his so stimulating essay on transparency, which I would like to discuss now. As you know, this essay, written 20 years before College City, was directly aimed against Gropius and Gideon, the great publicist of the modern movement, precisely. It is, in fact, a very precise attack against a particular moment in space-time and architecture, where Gideon celebrates the conquest of transparency in modern architecture by proposing the workshop wing of the Bauhaus by Gropius as the equivalent, the architectural equivalent of a painting by Picasso, L'Arlésienne, painted 20 years before the Bauhaus was built. A painting which is characteristic of that particular period that art historians call analytical cubism. Gideon, in this particular moment in space-time and architecture, explains that the famous glass walls of the Bauhaus, contrary to those of the 19th century, were not only big framed windows, they continuously wrapped the building as a real curtain, he says, and gave it a crystal transparency. The glass walls melted into one another with no joint, no solution of continuity, where the eye expected the presence of a pillar. And Gideon explained that we could see here, for the first time, as in a real built manifesto, the interpenetration in a great architectural complex of interior and exterior spaces. And this same interpenetration, says Gideon, exists precisely in L'Arlésienne, where face is simultaneously presented frontally and profile. So. And Gideon concluded a few lines later by giving even a moral meaning to this famous transparency achieved by the building, explaining that it gives an answer to the main problem facing modern architecture, that is, the reconciliation and fusion of individuals and society. So without contesting, arguing against the interest of comparing modern architecture and modern painting, Rowe and Slutsky are nevertheless going to develop a very precise and elaborate argumentation to show that this equivalence proposed by Gideon is deeply inaccurate, and that it lays even on a confusion, on a misunderstanding, which in fact comes from an ambiguity which is nestled in the concept of transparency itself. Hmm? So to achieve this demonstration, Rowe and Slutsky are going to found on the great critical work of another big figure of modernism who emigrated from the Bauhaus to the United States, the Hungarian artist and critic Georgi Kepes. Georgi Kepes, who in 1944 had published his masterpiece called Language of Vision, a book that will be followed in the 50s and the 60s by many other collective wonderful books that Kepes will curate and edit, gathering many artists, historians, and scientists also, as, for example, in 1956, The New Landscape in Art and Science. So you can appreciate the efficiency or perversity of Colin Rowe's demonstration in transparency when you know that Language of Vision was right from its first edition prefaced by Siegfried Gideon. It may be useful to say two words of this most influential work, Language of Vision. And I, for that, will just read the first lines of the introduction given by Kepes to the book. Today, he says, we experience chaos, the waste of human and material resources, and the canalization of almost all creative effort into blind alleys bear witness to the fact that our common life has lost its coherency. In the focus of this eclipse of a healthy human existence is the individual torn by the shattered fragments of his formless world, incapable of organizing his physical and psychological needs. This tragic formlessness is the result of a contradiction in our social existence. It indicates our failure in the organization of that new equipment with which we must function if we are to maintain our equilibrium in a dynamic world. So we need, that's the main idea of the book, we need a new visual language. It must be elaborated, a new visual language that will be used by artists and publicized by them as one of the most powerful educational instruments able to reunite man with his own knowledge and to reform him into an integral being who is in possession of himself in an ever-changing world. Okay. So, Language of Vision is one of the great manuals, great books of modern plastic arts, aiming at enlarging the visual language to other syntaxes than those inherited from art history, other syntaxes that would better fit to the new space-time experiences of our changing world. And in this sense, the conventional perspective codified by Renaissance painters and architects must not anymore, says Kepes, be considered as the privileged medium of visual communication. And it is in the course of this questioning of the privilege of traditional perspective that Kepes evokes, among others, this other and fundamentally modern way of representing spatial depth, which he calls transparency or interpenetration. This transparency is presented by him as a particular case of a more general and traditional way of representing depth by overlapping figures. Okay? And the definition given by Kepes of this transparency is the following. If one sees two or more figures partly overlapping one another, and each of them claims for itself the common overlapped part, then one is confronted with a contradiction of spatial dimensions. To resolve this contradiction, one must assume the presence of a new optical quality. The figures are endowed with transparency. That is, they are able to interpenetrate without an optical destruction of each other. Transparency, however, implies more than an optical characteristics. It implies a broader spatial order. Transparency means a simultaneous perception of different spatial locations. Space not only recedes, but fluctuates in a continuous activity. The position of the transparent figures has equivocal meaning, as one sees each figure now as the closer, now as the further one. And Kepes, in the following lines, insists on the deep modernity of this kind of representation of depth, insisting on the fact that transparency would be also in focus in modern philosophy, modern psychology, modern physics, everything, and also modern literature, painting, etc., sculpture, everything, and architecture, and stage design too. And even it would be in everyday experience, and he gives the example, strange example, of radio waves. They melt together without confusion. Okay. So Rowe and Slutsky literally borrow this definition of transparency given by Kepes, a definition which they qualify as admirable. But they show immediately how different it is from the current meaning of the word. Current meaning that refers either to the physical quality of a substance or material, or on a more mental plane, refer to the idea of a perfect clarity. Rowe writes, here, the transparent ceases to be that which is perfectly clear and becomes instead that which is clearly ambiguous. So everything would be for the best if, and there would be no problem at all, if when they use the concept of transparency, the moderns, Gideon and Kepes himself, were not sometime in the biggest confusion, constantly passing from, without notice, from one meaning of transparency to the other. That is the problem, explains Rowe and Slutsky. So they propose to make a very clear distinction between those two kinds of transparency. They say transparency may be an inherent quality of substance, as in wire mesh or a glass curtain wall, and then we will speak of real or literal transparency. Or it may be an inherent quality of organization of the structure of form, as Kepes suggested to be, and then we should speak of a seeming or phenomenal transparency. So according to them, our feeling for literal transparency derives from two sources in modern art: machine aesthetic and cubist painting for literal transparency, and cubist painting only for phenomenal transparency. So, the confusion between the two kinds of transparency could be explained by the fact that those two kinds coexist in cubist painting, and particularly in paintings of this analytical cubist period. And that would explain that, you know, we take this kind of transparency as the equivalent of the Bauhaus or another one. But what is at stake here, then, is precisely to distinguish those two orders or levels of transparency. So now I will be quicker here. Colin Rowe and Slutsky are going to try, by successive binary comparisons, to proceed to a chemical isolation of those two kind of transparencies, okay? As if those two kind of transparencies were progressively diverging tendencies in modern arts that could be evidenced. So the first, that's not an opposition, the first image they show is a late Cézanne, where the two, in pre-cubist painting, where the two transparency would be present at the same time. There is a kind of, how do we say that, perspective by elevated perspective. Okay. We think that the the Montagne Sainte-Victoire is behind the rest, but there is a very strong grid of horizontal and vertical line that affirm the front appearance of the painting, and there is a big frontality, but at the same time we suppose that there is a deep space because it's figurative at the same time. Then, second comparison, sorry, is this one between two cubist painting of 1911 around, one of Pablo Picasso and one of Georges Braque. And Rowe and Slutsky explains that those two paintings evidence this one because of these oblique lines, more figurative, evokes more the idea of literal transparency, even if there is also fluctuating space characteristic of phenomenal transparency. But this one, where the grid would be more affirmed with Braque, would be more illustrating phenomenal transparency, equivocal meaning of the different things. Then, here, in this comparison between Delaunay and Juan Gris, we would have here a more explicit example of literal transparency, the painting suggesting celluloid planes through which you see other things. You feel this idea of seeing through different planes, objects, and or planes situated behind them. Whether here, on the contrary, where transparent objects are also represented, here windows, here bottles, there would be a strong affirmation of the background also, and a very equivocal position of object that you can still recognize. You know. But you know, the space, background, and foreground would be fluctuating. There is not a suggestion of literal depth as here. There is more shallow and abstract space made of representative objects at the same time. And it would be still better expressed here in this comparison of two pictures of painted 20 years after. That's by Moholy-Nagy, where we have a cubist figure
but floating in a, they say, a personal interpretation of intergalactic space. Okay. Moholy would retain from Cubism the figure, but not the fluctuation with the background. Okay. There is only one possible interpretation of this space here. Something is floating in a deep space. Here, on the contrary, with these very affirmed grid again, and different three parts, those three parts of and the object on those three parts continually recede and advance, and you can't really assign them a place in the profondeur, in the depth of the plane. So we would be in front of an equivocal space here, shallow. The end of the demonstration, in the end of this first part, in spite of the modernity of motif, Moholy's picture still shows the conventional pre-cubist foreground, middle ground, and background. And in spite of a rather casual interweaving of surface and depth elements introduced to destroy the logic of this deep space, Moholy's picture can be submitted to only one reading. But the case of Léger is very different. For Léger, through the refined virtuosity with which he assembles post-cubist constituents, makes completely plain the multifunction behavior of clearly defined form. Through flat planes, through an absence of volume suggesting its presence, through the implication rather than the fact of a grid, through an interrupted checkerboard pattern simulated by color, proximity, and discrete superimposition, he leads the eye to experience an inexhaustible series of larger and smaller organization within the whole. Léger's concern is with the structure of form, Moholy's with materials and lights. And so, these three comparisons, they conclude, may clarify some of the basic difference between literal and phenomenal transparency in the painting of the last 45 years. Literal transparency, we might notice, tends to be associated with the trompe-l'œil effect of a translucent object in a deep, naturalistic space, while phenomenal transparency seems to be found when a painter seeks the articulated presentation of frontally aligned object in a shallow, abstracted space. And the problem, says Colin Rowe, is now to extrapolate the concept of phenomenal and literal transparency into architecture. The fact is that as Gideon, comparing the workshop curtain wall of the Bauhaus of Gideon, or Kepes in his book, when they try to give an equivalent of transparency, immediately give an equivalent of literal transparency. So, to their point of view, the comparison between the two, l'Arlésienne and the workshop wing of the Bauhaus, is deeply inaccurate. To a phenomenal transparency, which they pretend to admire in the painting, they give as an equivalent a literal transparency of an unequivocal plane giving on an unequivocal space, says the text. And here you see the following, just after his own definition of transparency, Kepes gives himself an example of an architectural equivalence, it could be Mies or Johnson or I don't know what, of purely literal transparency. And he explains that contemporary architecture uses the transparent quality of synthetic materials, glass, plastic, etc., to create a design that will integrate the greatest possible number of spatial vistas. Inside and outside are in close relationship, and each viewpoint in the building offers the widest visible comprehension of space. Reflections and mirrorings, transparent and translucent building materials are carefully calculated and organized to focus divergent spatial vistas in one visual grasp. So Kepes, as Gideon, makes the same mistake in Rowe's judgment. So the second part of the text is going to proceed to two other comparisons to demolish the equivalence established by Gideon. The first one will be between the hedgehog and the fox, that is, between the workshop ale of the Bauhaus and the Villa Stein. And the second one will be between the complex of the Bauhaus as a whole and another project by Le Corbusier, which is the project for the Palais des Nations in Geneva. Here we find, explained Rowe and Slutsky, an equivalent, architectural equivalent of phenomenal transparency. All the photographs taken by Le Corbusier shows it themselves because they express frontality. They look at the building frontally, like that. And the building itself would be made to be apprehended frontally. It is made, they explain, of a series of vertical planes more suggested than real, fragmentary, a succession of vertical plane, the back of the terrace, the receding ground floor, which are the same level than this repère here. So you have fixed points that suggest to you, when you approach the villa, a series of different vertical planes slided behind one another. And when you enter the building, you would be confronted with a contradiction, because you project your expectation on the building from those planes that are projected by you. Okay? You expect that the house be organized like a series of spaces slided behind one another. And the house, on the contrary, is largely organized in the depth. So when you enter the house, you have to correct your lecture of the space, and it is a continuing re-lecture. It is as if you were visiting 2, 3, 4, 5 houses nestled in the same building. Those different lectures doesn't eclipse the others, but enrich themselves. They are contradictory, but they coexist, okay? And you can choose to see the house that way or that way, and it's very similar to the idea of Freud about this four-dimensional Rome, you see? This city, four-dimensional, where all the stratas of its own history will be simultaneously present. But here it's on the plastic plane, and in Freud it's on the time-space plane. But we could also do another comparison with the fugues of Bach. There is many different voices, okay. Sometimes a note is not even played, but you hear it because it is suggested by the melodic line of one voice. So it's the same here. The planes, of course, they are not totally existent. If so, it would be just an opaque building, opacity. but there is a suggestion of frontality, narrowing of depth, which is contradicted, and thus its phenomenal transparency. So while literal transparency in architecture gives depth, on the contrary, phenomenal transparency would retain depth and finally give it. And what is very interesting and very strange at the same time is that in the text, Colin Rowe and Slutsky say that it works also horizontally, on horizontal planes. And they use, to show it, those axonometries here. And they say, here you have a plane, then you have another, then you have another. And with double heights inside the house, you perceive those different planes, and there is the same equivocal meaning of the different layers of the building that you experience while you visit the house. So, end of the first demonstration. Wait, they say, so much might be said for a reading of the internal volumes in terms of the vertical planes. And a further reading in terms of the horizontal planes, the floors, will reveal similar characteristics. Thus, throughout this house, there is that contradiction of spatial dimensions, which Kepes recognizes as characteristic of transparency. There is a continuous dialectic between fact and implication. The reality of this deep space is constantly opposed to the inference of shallow, and by means of the resultant tension, reading after reading is enforced. The five layers of space which vertically divide the building's volume and the four layers which cut it horizontally will all, from time to time, claim attention, and this gridding of space will then result in continuous fluctuations of interpretation. Second moment, because they want to destroy completely the argument of Gideon. And Gideon said that it was a manifesto, the Bauhaus of transparency, at the scale of a complex of building. So they have to destroy the idea that the Bauhaus would be an equivalent of transparency, not only through a destruction of the literal transparency of the aisle of the workshop wing, but also at the scale of the whole building. And here it is the same opposition. Here they say you have in the plan of the Bauhaus a characteristic, a dog leg plan. A kind that rotates like that, privileging oblique views on the building. When you approach this building, you will always have something like a first plane, a middle, and a background defined by the building itself. Okay? So the depth of space will be always real, literal, in your apprehension of the building. On the contrary, here with the Palais des Nations, there is the same organization of the building on parallel planes and the suggestion of their projection on the site itself. So you know that people were meant to come from there and then go through the little different coulisses of the trees also, and they would expect from their arriving like that to find a space organized frontally to enter. And they would discover, in fact, that each part of their percours to the building had a different meaning, was opening on a lateral view instead. So there would be the same contradiction of space experience at the scale of a complex of building. In this case, I just read you the end of the text. These stratifications devices by means of which space become constructed, substantial, and articulate, are the essence of that phenomenal transparency which has been noticed as characteristic of the central post-cubist tradition. They have never been noticed as characteristic of the Bauhaus, for obviously there, completely different space conceptions are manifest. In the League of Nations project, Le Corbusier provides the observer with a series of quite specific locations. At the Bauhaus, the observer is without such point of reference. Although the League of Nations project is extensively glazed, except in the auditorium, such glazing is scarcely of capital importance. At the Palace of the League of Nations, corners and angles, as the indices of spatial dimension, are assertive and definite. At the Bauhaus, Gideon tells us, they are dematerialized. At the Palace of the League of Nations, space is crystalline. But at the Bauhaus, it is glazing which gives the building a crystalline translucence. At the Palace of the League of Nations, glass provides a surface as definite and as taut as the top of a drum. But at the Bauhaus, glass walls flow into one another, blend into each other, wrap around the building, and in other ways, contribute to that process of loosening up which now dominates the architectural scene. And they are quoting another passage of Gideon. But we look in vain, it's the end, the last paragraph of the text, we look in vain for loosening up in the Palace of the League of Nations. There is no evidence there of any desire to obliterate sharp distinction. Le Corbusier's plane are like knives for the proportionate slicing of space. If we could attribute to space the qualities of water, then his building is like a dam by means of which space is contained, embanked, tunneled, sluiced, and finally spilled into the lake. So they are, to sum up, repeating the same demonstration exactly at the scale of the Palace of the League of Nations, at the scale of, we could say, urbanism or complex of building, buildings located into a site. But strangely, the demonstration here seems to me, I don't know if it's the case for you, a little deceptive. In the case of the building of the Villa Stein in Garches, it's wonderful, I think. Here, it only repeats the same thing, and it's even less rich, because there is not this interpretation on the horizontal plane, too. Why? Is it a default defect of the project itself, or the fact that it has not been built and you can't measure its, I don't know, its relationship with the ground, for example? Or is it a default of the analyze itself? I think the transposition of phenomenal transparency by Colin Rowe and Slutsky from painting to architecture is wonderful. But it seems to me that it's not so wonderful when they pass from building itself, just building, to complex of building, to urbanism, to landscape. It's strange also because when you look at Le Corbusier's text, when he himself explains the project of the League of Nations, he insists 6 or 7 or 8 page long, the beginning of the explanation of Le Corbusier of his project, is about the site. And characteristically, Le Corbusier speaks of this site as a succession, an assemblage of planes, horizontal planes, the lake, the banks, the slope, gentle slope where the building will be located, that slowly goes down to the lake. You know, there is 5 pages about those different planes, and he explains to that his project will mainly establish the zero level, he says. That is to say that his building will be all on the same level, horizontal level, the floor, you know, beginning at the ground level and slowly emerging, slowly letting the topography, the ground, slide under the building to the lake. So that in front of the lake, you have pillars of 9 meters high. Okay. And he explains it's very important, you know, this distinction. There is a depth of space under the building. It's strange, maybe you could say this zero level is also a kind of zero level of transparency, of horizontal transparency. This pure opposition of the level of architecture and the level of nature. You could say that's literal horizontal transparency, maybe. Rowe is not interested in that. That's Latourette explaining about the same gesture that would have been the gesture of the Palace of the League of Nations in its relationship to the site. Very binary relationship. There is a level of architecture and there is the site. No fluctuation, no, between those two planes, horizontal planes. I think that there are areas where this fluctuation between different horizontal planes that are more suggested than real can be experienced and has been organized and manipulated in landscape architecture. And I will give only one example, maybe one of the good example of that, in Vaux-le-Vicomte, where you have a great frontality also of the plan, symmetry, grid, you know, of the garden. And when you are back, the castle is just behind you and you're looking at the garden, you have a suggestion of a unique plan like that, of the garden. But then, when you look closer, when you see here how it's made, you see that it's not at all in a plane, on a plane level, on one plane only. You see that the topography shifts here. You are higher than here. But then here, on the contrary, you're higher on this side than on this side. And Le Nôtre didn't level everything. He let those differences express themselves, but in a grid of different planes, as you can see very clearly here, for example. You see that this side is higher than this one, if you look at it clearly. You know, the planes of topography of nature, before the garden, I'd say, has been interpreted and conserved as a plane, also. And he melts. No, he doesn't melt. He contradicts the symmetrical plane that is apparent, but coexists with him. Okay. And when you further discover the garden, it's a succession of different horizontal planes that you discover while walking. And you discover also a vertical, transparency also. You know, discovering that a particular fountain, for example, that made sense in the actual organization of the garden is also an element of transversal axes, etc., etc., that each piece of the garden plays different role in different spatial organization. It's true on the vertical plane, but it's true also, and it's magic even in those gardens on the horizontal plane too. So I think there is an interest to horizontalize phenomenal transparency, to apply phenomenal transparency or the idea of phenomenal transparency to the managing the design of the ground itself, and that we see that it's very much in focus in these gardens. And I would add something, that those are not only plastic planes, that when you deal with the ground, with the landscape, you deal with meaning connotations of different planes. When you discover, for example, this low plane of the river, you know, you also discover the plane of water, of Neptune, of all different literary and landscape connotations that are enforced by sculptures here, by things, you know. There is a literary, a meaning connotation of those different planes. That movement discover progressively. Colin Rowe got interested also in meaning connotations at the scale of the city. But strangely, you know, when he compares, because we could say that this comparison that he makes in College City has something to do with transparency. That is, this comparison, you know, here we would have a fluctuation between open and private space, built and unbuilt spaces. And the map would sometimes, you know, it's gestalt exercise like that. But the city which he likes, the theaters of memories which he likes, it has something to do with equivocal meaning of. And on the contrary, the modern city here, the plan of Saint-Dié, you could only have one lecture of these, that is, objects posed onto a background, which is space. Here, much more complex, a fluctuation of meaning between the two. Now, you know that it has something to do with that, his praise, his demonstration in College City. So we could put in perspective his text on transparency and his cultural text on city planning. But I think that he misses also here in College City the question of horizontal planes. He is dealing with how to process collage, extension of cities, you know, from their with their syntax. Okay, but he doesn't. I think the problem, in two words, is not so much now the extensions of cities as the deepening of situation. And I think that I already show you. You know, I am a hedgehog myself, so I re-show here. The Parc de Lancy I showed last time as a perfect example for me. Here are the maps, you know, exploring precisely not the surface but the depth, historical depth, you know, many different historical maps put onto one another like that. And so to read this kind of maps, we are in the same kind of difficulty as when we look at a cubist painting, you know, to which layer appertains this figure, you know. And it seems very interesting to me that the Parc de Lancy, I would describe the Parc de Lancy as a way to treat, to address a site as not simply as a background onto which you pose, you dispose objects, but as a complex plane, you know, made of different layer, and all your objects that you put onto it are operating a kind of tension between those different layers, making them legible. The tunnel bridge making legible the little brook, and at the same time, the fillings of the road, of the new road, you know, operating. They are like ascenseurs, comment on dit, un ascenseur? Elevators between those different layers, I would say. Very discrete elevators. Sometimes with literal, it's literal memory sometimes, quoting the glass houses that are just near in the plain, quoting the little canal in the wall, you know. But it has to do most of the time rather with phenomenal transparency, memory. Many artists, I've already talked about Smithson, Robert Smithson, have explored, have addressed land as a deep, you know, stratification of layer to explore. I will today finish just by mentioning another artist, which is very, I like him very much, because in my opinion, he explored he explored the whole depth, not only underground, but overground also. And this is, of course, Gordon Matta-Clark. You probably know, the strange thing, he was a student in Cornell in architecture. He was a student in architecture in Cornell in 1962, so probably he had Colin Rowe as a teacher. Probably he stayed about 5 or 6 years, he was a student, something like that. And he even did this project, a little footbridge too, over a river during his tour. And there is this deep interest for ground also, urban ground in the early project. I won't describe this one, but of course this exploration of, I will just maybe read a little passage. Excuse me, 1 minute. Gordon Matta-Clark, this is a Bronx Floors, called Bronx Floors. Gordon Matta-Clark developed his technique of cutting by using abandoned buildings that he found by scouting around New York. These were his first major cuttings outside of his own living space. The cuts were undertaken as guerrilla actions, without benefit of permission from owners, and in the face of threats posed by patrolling police, roving gangs, and the danger created in the structures by the cut themselves. Plentiful and deserted, these buildings offered Matta-Clark his only real opportunity for experimentation at this time. He wanted to open up spaces, making them accessible by creating views and passageways that had not existed before. The sense of openness was further magnified by light that penetrated the architecture, transforming into sculpture. Creating keyhole views between spaces, Matta-Clark cut away that which had maintained an insistent privacy. The extractions made were erasures of what had existed, but also were liberations of alternative views and new points of perception. These fragments had innumerable associations triggered by their materials, such as homey linoleum, preserving not a personal past, but conserving a more generalized history of the urban culture from which they were derived. You see? So we could say that these cutting of buildings, you know, piercing of buildings, could be at one and the same time literal transparency. What is more literal than cutting a hole through the surface? But at the same time, we're rezoning in the meaning, in the layers of meaning and memory of the city, and had such a way, a kind of ambiguous meaning. Here you have this famous conical intersect that was realized just near Beaubourg. Beaubourg was not finished, and they were still demolishing few remaining buildings around it. And Mata Clark had the opportunity 15 days before the erasure of the building to make this conical intersect in the building. So an example of really literal transparency, but at the same time, look at the photographs. You know, look at this ambiguous space created by this literal piercing of the building, and how memory, how the story of the building, how things connected with all the life uses things are revealed through this. And those are my last slides. Two of the last projects by Mata Clark. This one is called Jacob Ladder. This was, I think it was in the Documenta in 1975, 6, 7, I don't remember. And it's just this very dangerous ladder aiming at the top of an old industrial chimney here. There's always very big danger with Mata Clark, you know, in every project. And this is one of the last, and it's a very sad story, because his brother, called Sebastian Batan, had committed suicide. And then he was invited to do an exhibition, and he mainly, in the exhibition in Paris, in the Galerie Yvon Lambert, dug the ground, you know, in the gallery. And the project was called Descending Steps for Batan, you know. And I think that's very moving, but at the same time very, very interesting and very stimulating as an example of how art with Smithson, but with him, you know, explore the vertical depth of horizontal planes, not only underneath, but also here. And I think it sums up what I meant when I was trying to say that today the great problem is not so much the extension of cities, they are already everywhere, but the deepening of situation. Thank you for your attention.
I always felt that Colin Rowe's interest in transparency was, as a lot else, of course, in Colin Rowe, a formal interest. Yeah, you get a similar sense in his writing. Yeah, and like, say, an artist might look at transparency. And I think clearly, your interest is taking off from this base, but I think you are, in a way, saying something quite different, and that the the value of transparency is not formal, it's something else, and I wonder whether you could say something about it.
Yes, of course. The whole thing I tried to do, but the whole thing I was trying to do was extrapolating, can you say that in English? Extrapolating the concept of phenomenal transparency into the four-dimensional space, four-dimensional space-time question. And I know, at the same, on one side, Colin Rowe extrapolated pictorial transparency into architectural transparency. He extrapolated the concept of phenomenal transparency to the three-dimensional space of architecture. I think that we can extrapolate this wonderful extrapolation again. And it interests me because in France, there is a strong opposition, in fact, between, you know, there is a neo-modern movement very strong in France, as you know. And Colin Rowe is one of their saints, I would say, because they are very happy with his praising the buildings and leaving the ideologies. Okay, you can work in Paris with modern architecture, so everything is perfect. And Colin Rowe is a master. And at the same time, they don't too much read College City. You know, they read the Colin Rowe of Le Corbusier, and they would happily forget the other one. The thing is, I think that there is no two Colin Rowes. And I think this extrapolation of phenomenal transparency to the horizontal plane of the ground as a step before extrapolating it to this four-dimensional that the layers of the earth and the ground express themselves. I think that this operation is contained in Rowe's movement. But for different reasons, he didn't do it exactly that way, I would say. I'm not saying that the true Colin Rowe is still to come. But I was just saying that he made a wonderful way and that we can pursue this way. Not being just fair to the way he did it, but continuing to extrapolate and explore the richness of their concept of transparency in other fields, which are the great fields today, in my opinion. I don't know if I'm clear.
Yes, I think you are. But I'm trying to actually make very precise connection between, say, what you are saying today and what you said 3 weeks ago. And I guess to put my question more bluntly is whether, at the end, your interest in transparency on the horizontal plane is underpinned by the importance which you ascribe to the idea of memory in the city. Is that, have I understood you right? In other words, that's what I was trying to, you know, the difference which I was trying to make between what you have said today and what Colin Rowe's interest, as I see it, yeah, in transparency is, yeah. That is, it's a formal conceit in a way. That's the way I relate to it. But I get a sense, especially for example with your last picture of the hall by Gordon Matta Clark and as a testimony to his brother. I mean, there is something which is very, very charged, yeah, in this image, which I would not imagine seeing the same way in Colin Rowe.
Yeah. No, of course. No, I agree with you. No, I did only halfway today, because I had announced something about not the art of memory, but the art of hope. So it was just a way to pointing to this other question here with Jacob's ladder and the hole. And in fact, I don't know exactly how to address this question of hope, which I will try tomorrow and the other day in seminar. But in fact, I think that this exploration of horizontal planes, as I tried to evidence with those two last images, mustn't be only a digging in the ground. It has to be something like that also, to deepen the underground, okay? But it has also to be an exploration of, I think that the corollaire, the counterpart, necessary counterpart of suburbanism, that is digging in the ground, is superurbanism. And that's one of the reasons why I mentioned this, I had this little part on Kohlhaas, which I don't want to develop now, but I'm much interested in a comparison between the way Swiss architects, that is Swiss people coming from those very high landscapes, treat, you know, just dig the surface of a little suburban area, try to, as opposed to those guys of the flatlands. And I think the first of them would not be Kohlhaas, but Constant, with this new Babylon, this you know, this other direction in the exploration of verticality. So I think those two things have to be put in tension together and not opposed, as I see them opposed today. I see on one side people, I don't know, screaming after losing little traces and things like that, and others claiming fuck context and everything. Maybe there's two disciplines here that should not despise themselves, I mean each other, but just stay, just explore two things. And some of them explore the two of them, maybe. And, you know, this is very impressionist, huh?
But very interesting.
I think those two things. And thinking about it, no. I just leave that because, but I am on the verge of thinking that there is two professions also, but it is two corporatists between, you know, landscape architects and architects. I don't want to say they're two professions, but they're two preoccupations, and they are real. You can make a profession out of each of them. That's just what I mean to say, and you can make a, it can be a wonderful adventure to try to put them in relationship to, I don't know. That's what I like. Memory, art of memory, art of hope. What is it? Art of hope. I've been talking about Colin Rowe. We should talk about another, an old thing also, which is Kevin Lynch. I'll try to do that in the seminar. I think there is many things to extrapolate in Kevin Lynch too, in the sense of the art of hope too. It has to be extrapolated, not just taken like it is, but they're wonderful books. What Time Is This Place? Have you ever read this book? I think it's an incredible book. Exploring the three dimension of memory, future, hope, etc. But still, we have to transform hope into an art. That's another story.
Probably we should stop there. But just to remind people that those from within the school, that Sebastian is holding seminars this week. You'll find where they are in the diary, and I'm sure everybody's very welcome there. Thank you very much.
Thank you.